Royal Caribbean's Oasis class cruise ships are the biggest cruise ships in the world, but how do they compare to the most well-known ship of all time? I've got a comparison up next. Hey everyone, it's Matt from RoyalCaribbeanBlog.com. Royal Caribbean Symphony of the Seas holds the title as the world's largest cruise ship, and Wonder of the Seas will be replacing that in just a little bit. So how does it compare to the Titanic? After all, Titanic is probably the most well-known ocean liner of all time because, of course, of its famous accident in 1912. Her sinking has never been eclipsed in the public imagination, despite decades of larger and, quite frankly, safer cruise ships. Nonetheless, if you mention cruise ships to somebody who is brand new to cruising, inevitably, the Titanic references usually follow. Now, I'm sure there's somebody who's already writing a comment below, Matt, Titanic was an ocean liner, Symphony of the Seas is a cruise ship. They're not anything like each other. You'd be actually correct. Ocean liners and cruise ships, while colloquially might be considered the same thing, they're really not. Ocean liners were about getting from point A to point B. They brought people from Europe to North America, vice versa, and all other places around the world. Cruise ships are about pleasure, about enjoying a vacation, and they're purpose-built to have a great time while on board, whereas Titanic and the other ocean liners of that era were about getting you from point A to point B, and maybe along the lines, in the case of Titanic, they had some really luxurious accommodations on top of that. So yes, you're 100% right that there is a difference. However, the general public doesn't know that difference, and the general public loves to ask, okay, how does this ship compare to Titanic? Because the general public still has Titanic burned into their collective psyche, so it just comes up all the time. And so today's video is about comparing the two, even though, technically speaking, you're right, we're comparing two very different types of ocean-going vessels, but go with me on this one. Let's start by meeting the world's largest cruise ship, which right now is Symphony of the Seas when this video came out, but Wonder of the Seas is going to be coming out just after this. It's almost irrelevant because they're very much the same ship in terms of size, just a few meters apart, but at about five times the size of the Titanic, the world's largest cruise ship is, again, Symphony of the Seas. Spanning 18 decks, Symphony of the Seas is the fourth Oasis-class cruise ship to be launched, and size is everything with Symphony, as she's 1,184 feet, 5 inches in length, and if you were to stand her up, she's almost as tall as the Empire State Building, which is 1,250 feet without any of her antennas on there. There are also 25 pools, whirlpools, flow rider surf simulators, and water slides to enjoy on Symphony of the Seas. Getting around the ship is pretty easy as well, thanks to the neighborhood concept that Royal Caribbean developed for these ships. There are 7 neighborhoods inside the ship to help distinguish areas from each other and make navigation for guests simpler. On Wonder of the Seas, they've actually added an 8th neighborhood, the Suite neighborhood, which adds another area of navigation for guests on board. You're going to find on Symphony of the Seas 2,759 staterooms, including 188 suites and 28 more balconies than the next largest ship in the fleet, which is Harmony of the Seas. So now, let's compare Symphony of the Seas to the Titanic. Not only is Symphony of the Seas larger than the Titanic, all of the Oasis-class cruise ships are larger than the Titanic in gross tonnage as well as size. The Titanic measured in at 882 feet and 9 inches long and weighed 46,328 gross tons. Symphony of the Seas measures 1,184 feet, 5 inches in length, and has a gross tonnage of 228,081 gross tons. In terms of gross tonnage, Titanic doesn't even make the list of the top 64 world's largest cruise ships by gross tonnage. Doodle for length. Among the top 64 largest cruise ships in the world today, the shortest cruise ship comes in at 984.1 feet with the Ida Prima and Ida Perla cruise ships. Titanic was built at an estimated cost of $7.5 million in 1912, which in today's dollars would be approximately $400 million. Symphony of the Seas cost $1.35 billion to construct. Titanic could handle 2,453 passengers, while Symphony of the Seas has a capacity of 5,518 passengers at double occupancy. But what could you have done on both ships? Well, in terms of things to do, Titanic offered a heated pool, gym, squash court, and Turkish bath. Symphony of the Seas has 25 pools, 2 flow rider surf simulators, 2 rock walls, a full-size basketball court, ice skating rink, mini golf course, and a carousel, and there's plenty more on top of that. In the evening, Titanic would offer smoking rooms, billiards, music, and dancing. On Symphony of the Seas, you can also find the Broadway musical Hairspray, ice skating shows, piano bars, karaoke, a jazz club, live music, movie screenings, and production shows in the Aqua Theater. But how much is a ticket on the Titanic versus Symphony of the Seas? Any cruise fan knows there's no standard price for a cruise. Cruise fares vary from ship to ship and even sailing to sailing. It's not unreasonable to pay around $2,000 for a balcony cabin for two guests on a seven-night Symphony of the Seas sailing. The prices of tickets on the Titanic in 1912 range from £30, equivalent to £3,000 in 2019, and £870, equivalent to £100,027 in 2021 for a parlor suite and small private promenade deck in first class, to £8 for a third class adult fare and £3 for children. That's roughly equal to between $345 and $100,000 in today's prices. Now, unlike modern cruise ships, Titanic had different classes of fares, first, second, and third class, which were distinguished by social status and ticket cost. First class was for the wealthiest and most prominent passengers. These were upper-class people who had careers in business, politics, the military, or industry. These were the well-to-do and the most well-known people sailing on the ship. Second class was essentially the middle-class people, which might include tourists, members of the clergy, and educators. And third class, sometimes known as steerage, was mostly made up of immigrants moving to North America. So now let's really get into how do these ships compare. Well, in short, Symphony of the Seas and the Titanic don't have a ton in common besides being ships that move on the water. Today's cruise ships are very different than ocean liners like Titanic. What many people who are new to cruise ships fail to understand is the fundamental shift leisure cruising underwent in the second half of the 20th century. Ocean liners and ferries evolved into what we now know as cruise ships. Ocean liners, like Titanic, were primarily used to bring passengers across the ocean from one point to another, whereas cruise ships could go on pleasure voyages closer to the coast, sailing between ports. Unfortunately, many cruise novices have Titanic as their only frame of reference when it comes to non-cargo ships, so it ends up being the de facto benchmark, right or wrong. So not only are ships like Symphony of the Seas immensely larger, the experience on board is vastly different, with more to see, do, and eat than anybody on Titanic could ever have dreamed about. Now, because we're talking about Titanic, it's hard to ignore the fate of Titanic and the fact that she sank, and a lot of people, especially people who are brand new to cruising, are still worried about it going on a cruise ship today because that image, that memory of Titanic, especially the movie, certainly plays a role in their understanding of cruise ships and what can possibly happen. You should know that obviously a lot has changed in the cruise ship industry since Titanic. We talked already about some of the changes structurally in terms of what's available on board, but under the hood, ocean-going vessels have evolved quite a bit. The most significant difference between the Titanic and modern cruise ship designing is the holding together of the hull. The Titanic's design details using over 3 million rivets for its hull and upper deck structure. However, these rivets highlight three times the allowable slag content for a safe design. Under the impact of a heavy collision, such rivets start a domino effect. It makes an entire section of the hull collapse altogether at once and uncontrollable in aggressive water. Compared to this, modern cruise ships use a submerged arc welding. The welding action takes place in a single run with more than one seams for extra assurance. Hence, any damage to a section of the cruise ship today limits the area of impact without multiplying. Every inch of these welds undergoes ultrasonic testing before submersion as a mark of quality testing. It also includes testing 30% or more cross joints by the class surveyor before going underway. You've got to remember that while Titanic's streamlined design was a true advance in naval architecture, it was still limited by the technology restrictions and lack of simulation at that time, and those are significant reasons for her inevitable final failure. In the decades since Titanic, many changes to the structure and construction of cruise ships have evolved, and the result has been quite a difference in how cruise ships are designed and built before they ever see passengers on board. And while we're talking about the sinking of Titanic, there's also one major difference that will never happen today, and that is the unsafe practice that Titanic had in terms of its lifeboat and life raft capacity. The impact of the iceberg was one thing, but the fact that so many people died was because they didn't have a lot of lifeboats on board, something that's changed quite a bit. The plans show only 20 lifeboats on Titanic, each with a capacity of 65 passengers in an emergency. Hence, 1,300 passengers at maximum capacity are the boarding capacity with all the lifeboats in the water. With the evolution of SOLAS, or Safety of Life at Sea, this blunders corrections highlights the safety recognition. As a result, a total of 125% of the maximum capacity of passengers is now compulsory for passenger cruise ships. It also includes at least 50% of the passenger number in closed-type lifeboats. The Act ensures every passenger to have a guarantee of seating inside a lifeboat in the case of an emergency. Additionally, life rafts and other similar items make the capacity even higher. Each side, both port and starboard, need to have 50% LiPo carrying capacity with two or more launching means. So, in short, there's been a lot of changes to cruise ships from the days of the ocean liners like Titanic, not only in terms of what you can do on board, but also the safety features of them. So, if you're comparing Titanic to a modern cruise ship, well, they're nowhere near each other at any rate. But a lot of people still like to point the fingers between the two and say, how does that stack up? And occasionally you might even see one of these memes floating around of Titanic compared to the modern cruise ships. A lot has changed, and while they do go in the ocean, they're very more different than they are similar. Hope you enjoyed this video. Hit the like button if you did. Let me know in the comments which of these facts truly surprised you the most. And while you're down there, make sure you also subscribe to our channel and turn on your notifications. Hit that little bell icon so that way YouTube lets you know when we have a brand new video to share. This has been Matt from RoyalCaribbeanBlog.com, and we'll talk again real soon.